presentation will be by the brilliant Dr. Jones, and I have to say he's brilliant because I have a class with him and I need a good grade. But he's really brilliant. So he received an MA in philosophy from the University of Houston in 2008 and a PhD in philosophy from Indiana University in 2013. He teaches courses in philosophy and cognitive science at UE and directs the cognitive science program. Derek has published and presented work on such topics as scientific explanation, self-knowledge, skilled behavior, and free will. His work is organized around the project of understanding cognition and action as essentially embodied biological processes. His forthcoming book, The Biological Foundations of Agency, is slated for publication in June 2016. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Jones.
Gabriella, and as I'm pulling this up, thanks to the organizers for putting this together. I think a lot of people can agree that things associated with the Syrian refugee crisis are really important, but it's one thing to think that something's really important, and it's another thing altogether to actually do something about it. So just thanks to the organizing committee for putting this together. My job's relatively easy. I get to show up and talk about some things I think are interesting. They really sort of deserve the lion's share of the credit for all of this. So I'm Derek, and this is what I'm interested in. So I'm not an expert on public policy or politics or anything else like that, especially in the current political climate. When I watch the news, I like to pretend I'm from another planet and I'm not reserved the right to leave at any time. But when this came up, I thought, well, okay, so is there some way that I can sort of contribute to this? Is there something I can come up with? And I realized that I kind of had an angle and something that I thought might be valuable and worth sharing. So xenophobia in the United States is not an uncommon thing, and it's come in waves. So, right, and first of all, getting our terms clear, xenophobia, I mean the irrational fear or hatred or dislike of foreigners, of unfamiliar people, of the other, and stuff like that, right? And the thing that I really want to sort of emphasize here is that it's an irrational fear, right? So you could have a rational fear of other people, right? If your country is literally being invaded and people are dragging people from their homes and killing them, it's okay to be afraid of them, I think. That's a perfectly rational, well-justified fear, right? But when we talk about xenophobia, we mean that it's a sort of an unwarranted fear. We've gone through some process of reasoning that's led to us thinking that there's a threat where there isn't one, and we're treating people unfairly because of this. And it seems like, it comes in waves, right? So we start off awfully xenophobic, and then it passes, and then we look back on the previous generation, and we think, wow, that was ridiculous. Why in the world would we have treated people like that? And we do that right up to the point where we start treating people like that again. And what that suggests is, first of all, we're not learning from history, but I think also we're not learning from psychology. And so what I was really interested in is trying to see, well, what are the sorts of mechanisms that are associated with xenophobic behavior? And is there any way that sort of reflection on how these things work, what they respond to, how they interact with each other, could maybe sort of inoculate us against the next sort of wave of it, right? So there's a sense in which I'm hoping that a better understanding of cognitive psychology is going to help us to maybe be a little less awful in the future. And whether it works, we'll find out, I guess. These days, it's pretty easy to find examples, right? So there's this guy, and I won't do an impression. It's hard not to when you read it, but right, when Mexico sends its people, they're not sending the best. They're sending you people that have lots of problems, and they're bringing problems with us. They're bringing drugs, crime, they're rapists, and some, I assume, are good people. Right? So you have this, and of course, then there's this guy. I will build a great wall, and nobody builds them better than me, and I'll build them very inexpensively. And I'll make Mexico pay for that wall, mark my words, right? And of course, we also have this guy. Sources told me that Barack Obama's birth certificate is a fraud. And another one, I'm calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what's going on, right? It seems as though I'm piling on, but really, if you do a Google search for American xenophobia, this is what you find first. Now this last one, right, comes on the heels of something that, hopefully is still kind of fresh in our memory, right, which was the Paris terror attacks of 13 November, right? And this was a really serious thing, right? So this is a coordinated attack in multiple locations. ISIL took responsibility for it, and this was, something that, the world, or at least, big chunks of the world were sort of united around briefly. And it took a day or two for us to start assigning blame, and sometimes assigning blame in the wrong places, right? So one thing that we found was a Syrian passport near the body of one of the perpetrators. Okay? And that's pretty much all it took, right? Because meanwhile, we have Syrian refugees trying to find, you know, safe haven in other countries. And, well, we find this and we think, well, what might happen, right? We're worried now about Trojan horse attacks or something like that, right? So, you know, we're helping all these good people, but then there might be dangerous people that are going to sneak in under the radar or something like that. And of course, well, so there's a link between Syrian refugees and terrorism. The passport nails it. Except, of course, that a couple days later we realized that it didn't nail it at all, right? The Syrian passport was a fraud. The actual gentleman whose information was on the passport had died well before any of this happened. And in fact, Serbian police picked up somebody that had the exact same information somewhere else, right? So it was a fraudulent passport in the first place. And it turned out that, in fact, if you want to travel between the Middle East and Europe, what you do is you get a fake passport and you pass through the porous Greek border, which at the time was really understaffed. And, well, you could just go in and out. You answer a few questions, you sign your name, and then you just move on to the next thing, right? So none of this implicates Syrians. It could have been anybody. Moreover, the assailants were later confirmed as EU nationals from France and Belgium. Okay? Moreover, right, thinking from our perspective, who do we want to let into the country and who do we not want to let into the country, to come here from Syria is an exhaustive process, right? You've got to, you know, biometric tests. You've got to answer all sorts of questions, interviews. It can take up to 2 years. If you emigrate, if you come over from France and Belgium, it takes virtually nothing, right? So if you're a terrorist that wants to get into the United States, you don't come through Syria, right? You don't go through those channels. You go through Europe. Now, what all of this suggests, right, is that we didn't have good reason to think that Syrian refugees were going to be the problem, okay? And again, right, the thing I'm harping on here is that xenophobia is an irrational fear. So we didn't have good reason to think that this was true, but we thought it anyway, right? And it was all over the media, in large part because we had some, at least, you know, sort of the American collective consciousness had one thing in the back of their minds, and that was radical Islam, right? Which does not look like this, unfortunately, right? So, out of curiosity, so I googled radical Islam, and I was, the one time that the internet gave me a little bit of faith was the number of rock bands and skateboarding Muslims I found. But most likely this is not what people had in mind when they were afraid, right? And by the way, it's interesting that this isn't what pops into your mind, right? Tehranian skateboarders and Syrian punk bands are not ordinarily what the average American associates with the Middle East or with Islam or anything like that, right? Unfortunately, the other Google image searches had stuff like this. Right, so the West, right, I apologize for the sort of pixelated quality of it, but I disagree with what you say about I will defend to the death your right to Glurk, and then the Islamic savage beheads him, right, because that's what they do. And this is more often what people are afraid of when they think of radical Islam, right? And the real concern is, well, if we open our doors to these people, if, you know, being the kind, benevolent people that we are, we open our doors and our hearts to them, they're going to murder us, or at least some of them are, right? What percentage of them might? And the only thing that we can really be sure of is, well, the possibility is some number greater than zero. Okay? Right? And probably that's true. By the way, the possibility of someone in this room murdering me right now is greater than zero, right? and it may go up as the talk goes on. The point here is that, well, even we didn't have a really good reason, again, to think this, but we've got this image in our heads, right? And it influences the kind of policy that we make. So sure enough, right, shortly afterwards, Bobby Jindal signs an executive order instructing state agencies to take all available steps to stop Syrian relocation. 31 states publicly refuse Syrian refugees. Now, the constitutionality of this is in question, stuff like that, it's a separate thing. But the fact is that people thought that it was important to take a stand like this, right? And they were probably rewarded for it by their constituents. Okay. Scott Walker, right, happened to just come up on the search. There will be those who try to take advantage of our generosity and the ability to move freely within our borders, and we must ensure that we are doing all we can to safeguard the security of Americans. This fellow. Our governor, Mike Pence. While India has a long tradition of welcoming refugees to our state, I believe it is appropriate to suspend resettlement efforts until the administration and the conference engage in an exhaustive review and bring about the kinds of changes that can assure us that people coming into this company, or into this country, sorry, don't represent a threat to the people of my state, right? So in these cases, right, the idea is we have a perceived threat, and we're going to close ranks until we can get that threat level down to zero, right? Which, again, is kind of an unreasonable goal, right? So really what it amounts to is closing borders and just not letting people in until, I guess, we just quit feeling scared. Now, just to be clear, this isn't a new thing, right? So if you visit the Scholars from Syria Facebook page, you'll find all sorts of really cool news articles that have been posted recently, and I assume because of this talk, related to xenophobia. And there are a lot of really neat sort of political cartoons and things like that. So this is, well, way back when, so in 1870, this is the threat posed by the Roman Catholic Church and the Mormon Church, which if you read one of the articles posted on there, one of the big concerns about Mormons was that they weren't white enough. They were being lumped into sort of a category of other because of their beliefs and things like that. And so the concern was, well, I'll just read it for you. Religious liberty is guaranteed, but can we allow foreign reptiles to crawl all over us, right, or all over the U.S., right? So we've got this link to disgust, right? We've got these kind of awful things that are sort of creeping over, taking advantage of our goodwill, and they're going to destroy us in some way. They're going to do harm to us in some kind of way. And we can't allow that, right? We've been nice for too damn long, and now we've got to, you know, enough is enough, right? And of course, since then, right, the Roman Catholics have infiltrated. Everyone, I hope, is familiar with the Japanese internment, right, in the 1940s, right? So we had a concern that the Japanese Americans living among us might be spies, right? Not everyone was convinced of this. A lot of people in law enforcement thought it was kind of hokum, but we were afraid. And so what did we do? We rounded up hundreds of thousands, well over 100,000 people, some of whom were Native American or Native-born American citizens. Others weren't, but still. We sort of universally regard this as sort of a shameful chapter in our nation's history, right? Very few people get sort of jazzed about Japanese internment. We all sort of recognize that this was a mistake. So common elements of these things. The first bit, right, is there's this appeal to safety, right, as a way of justifying this kind of behavior, right? So outsiders are a threat. They're going to harm the republic. They're going to, you know, they're going to hurt people, right, and, you know, here, and we can't allow that, right? So it's a noble kind of virtuous justification given, right? You know, we don't want our people to be hurt. We don't, you know, we don't want the country to be taken down and so on. There's this weird kind of contempt or disgust that's associated with it, right? So, right, when we go back to, you know, the sort of reptilian threat of these religions and things like that, it's really common in political cartoons and things like that to have xenophobia expressed with these people being really ugly or gross or something like that, right? And there's an unusual sort of connection that I'm going to point to later on. As I know, there's really dubious support for these claims and actions, right? At the time, they seem like a really good idea, and everybody that's on board, you know, has reasons for why they're doing what they're doing. No one's interning people, and if you ask them why, they say, I have no idea, right? No, they have good reason. They think, well, there's a potential threat. They might be spies. They might be trying to hurt us. They might be terrorists, and so on, right? But the claims never get borne out, right? The statistical evidence doesn't support it. And because of that, history's judged these cases really harshly. Now, there's this other bit, though, right, is that when we look back at these previous cultures, or not cultures, when we look back at these previous people, these people that have done these things, we all think that, we all feel really intellectually distant from them, right? Yeah, there was people back then. People were really old and racist back then, right, or something like that. You know, it was a different time. They were like this, and this isn't the kind of thing that would happen to us, right? We're sort of the enlightened moderns. And so there's a sense in which we really feel like there's a kind of irrationality or an unreasonableness that previous xenophobes have displayed that we're somehow immune from. Okay. And I want to suggest that that's the really dangerous thing, right? Is to look at xenophobes and assume that they're fundamentally different from us in a way that would somehow shield us or bar us from becoming people like that. Okay. So here's a related sort of instance, right? So this is, you know, racism is slightly different from xenophobia, but right, here's something that I think some people sort of implicitly think in their heads, right? Here's how I know I'm not racist. Well, because racist people do horribly racist things, right? So I use, you know, cross-grained Klansmen, but pick whatever you want. They assault people of other races. They are, you know, they scream at them in the streets and things like that. And I don't do that. So I'm not racist, right? I've got a couple people that took logic with me, right? And they know that that is a perfectly valid inference in the sense that if one and two are true, then three follows. Okay? But note that that's seductive, right? Because it's a valid pattern of reasoning, right? I worked my way to the conclusion. I'm a reasonable guy, right? The problem is that you've misunderstood what racism is, right? Again, my logic students know what they misunderstood are the necessary conditions for racism, right? You can be racist without being a virulent, sort of horrible, right, out in the open racist, right? You can be subtly racist. You can display microaggressive behavior. You can participate in power structures that happen to disproportionately privilege one group of people over another. There's all sorts of ways. You can be sort of silently complicit in racist behavior, right? There's all sorts of ways you can. And so there's an idea that sort of, there's a kind of ignorance that sets you up for failure, right? And opens you up to potentially being a slightly less virtuous human being. I want to say there's something kind of similar going on here. So here's the deal. All xenophobes are irrational, right? And I'm not. Here's how I know. I've got good reasons for what I say and for what I do, right? Just ask me, right? And so, by right, bogus tolerance, my behavior's not, I'm not a xenophobe. My behavior's not xenophobic. Right? Now, I want to actually agree with premise one. I do want to say that all xenophobes are irrational. In fact, by definition, I think they are. Premise two is sketchy. Okay? For a couple different reasons. Okay? So, this first bit. I'm not irrational because I have reasons for what I say and do. Yeah, who doesn't? Okay? Crazy people don't know they're crazy. Yeah. And by the way, I can have reasons without having them be terribly good reasons, right? They could be really compelling to me for all sorts of reasons that have nothing to do with their sort of rational legitimacy, right? So the fact that I have reasons is kind of irrelevant. The question is, well, are they good reasons? Okay. So there's this problem of sort of self-deception that comes in here, right? And by the way, we're really, really committed to preserving sort of positive self-images, right? And there might be good evolutionary reasons for this, right? You don't. Chronically depressed animals don't survive as long as ones that are maybe more prone to, you know, having better self-images. But there's a second way that people will go. You say, okay, well, I have good reasons, and here's how I know I have good reasons, right? I've thought very hard about this. And the second bit is I'm not nuts, right? I'm not, there's nothing defective in my reasoning. I'm not crazy. I'm not one of these kinds of people. I've got a good job. People like me. I have friends that agree with the things that I say, right? The people on TV confirm what I'm saying. All these kinds of, you know, there's a whole bunch of reasons that suggest that I'm a perfectly rational, reasonable person. I'm not crazy like those other folks over there, right? And so the idea is that and what I think this relies on is this sort of really misguided definition of rationality, or of irrationality, is a kind of cognitive malfunction, right? The idea is that when I'm being irrational, my brain is breaking in some way, right? Something's not doing the job it's supposed to do. Okay? And I think that's a big mistake, and it's got a long story history, right? And I'm not going to get into it for the sake of time, but here's what a lot of people think that cognition is, okay? People think that cognition is what you do when you think really, really hard about math problems. And it is. Sometimes that is what you're doing. But most people take that as sort of the paradigm of cognition. I'm at my most cognitive when I'm thinking very rationally and clearly about abstract ideas or something like that, right? I'm deliberating. I'm thinking, you know, I'm reasoning. I'm doing logic, right? That kind of stuff. And well, that's what makes us human. That's what separates us from the lower animals and things like that. Well, what about emotion? Well, emotion is one of these kind of gross things that gets in the way with reason, right? You know, ideally we're Spock, right? We're the sort of being that doesn't let emotion sort of interfere with the way that we actually think through things. So what happens when we're irrational? Well, we're not sort of living up to our potential, right? We're breaking down. We're failing to achieve what's sort of uniquely cognitive about us. Irrational people are broken people in some kind of way, right? And again, I don't think anyone like explicitly says this to themselves when they wake up in the morning, but I do think that something like this idea is sort of lurking in the background of people think, I'm not like them, right? They're cognitively broken, I'm A-OK. And so, well, here we go. So here's a slightly modified case, right? So all xenophobes are defective cognitive agents. I'm not a defective cognitive agent. How do I know? Well, I've got all this kind of good stuff going on for me. I'm a nice person, just ask me. And so I'm not a xenophobe, and my behavior's not xenophobic, right? And the concern is, right, if I think I'm immune to something, I might risk catching it. Right. I mean, there's a slight parallel that we can make here, right, between this and, you know, immunizations and things like that, right? If I just assume on sort of my own good faith that nothing will harm me and I go around licking doorknobs, right, I'm very sick no matter what I believe. And I want to kind of suggest that there's a kind of cognitive immune system here that if you're not careful, it leaves you susceptible to bad ideas, right? And so what we're going to try to do is inoculate ourselves. Well, we're going to try to inoculate ourselves here. And here's the thing, is we're not good at knowing ourselves. So this gentleman is Daniel Kahneman. He won the Nobel Prize winner in 2002 with Amos Tversky, working on psychological processes that actually underlie decision-making, right? The idea is that we ordinarily think that when we're making decisions and choices, we think that we're reasoning probabilistically on the basis of statistics and things like that, but in fact, none of that's actually going on, right? Even though it seems to us as though we are, none of that's actually operative, right? There's a very different set of rules that our brains are following when we make these judgments. And ordinarily, it works great, but if you put us in the wrong circumstances, we behave not just irrationally, but predictably irrationally. So finally, let me tell you what I'm going to argue for. Here's the first bit. Our minds are not built for rationality and maybe not morality. They're built for adaptability. Here's the second bit. We've got a common cognitive organization. We all share this machinery. And in certain circumstances, that machinery can predispose us to xenophobic behavior, okay? We're not different from the xenophobes, okay? We have differences in circumstance, we have differences in maybe how we handle the outputs of that machinery, but we're not immune. And well, that's just what I have here. If we don't recognize these mechanisms, we're maybe at greater risk of allowing history to repeat itself. If we are aware, maybe we're okay, all right? Or at least we've got a fighting chance. Because we can either engage in what cognitive scientists call the metacognitive process, thinking about how we think, of overriding these mechanisms and showing, well, I know that this thing trips in this situation, and so I better kind of, you know, hedge my bets a little bit. Or changing our operational environment, right? Interchanging the world around me in ways that might not trip those switches in the same kind of way, right? And we'll talk about how that's supposed to work in a second. Okay. So why aren't we ideal cognitive agents? Because we inhabit massively complicated, complex, information-rich worlds, and we have finite amounts of time to navigate them, right? So if the tiger is coming at you, you do not have time to take in all of the information in the world around you and reason about every last bit of it, right? You have to determine what bits of the scene are relevant to you. You have to bump that information against your vast information store, all the beliefs that you have about the world and stuff like that. And meanwhile, the tiger is encroaching, right? Early organisms have to do a handful of things, right? They gotta find food, they gotta reproduce, they gotta avoid predators, right? You don't have time to take all the information in. You've gotta move faster than that. Sometimes that means taking cognitive shortcuts. So here's one way to kind of think about this, right? So we'll start metaphorical and then kind of work our way to more concrete. So I like to think about cognition as, and I'm stealing this from Andy Clark, this notion of a dashboard, right? So everyone's familiar with dashboards, I hope, right? So you've got a dashboard in your car, and most of you are probably competent drivers, and you're able to tell, well, you're able to read the stuff on the meter, but most of you probably have no idea how the stuff behind the dashboard works, right? What you have to work with are sort of the causal outputs of all the circuitry back there, right? All that stuff does whatever the complicated stuff the engineers make it do, and then I get this nice clean display and then I'm able to decide how I want to conduct myself, right? I get to decide, oh, you know, I'm low on gas, how do I know? Because the lever's like this and the light is on, right? I don't know what any of the stuff behind it is doing, I just read the outputs, right? And one way of thinking about cognition is, well, that's how we work, right? The amount of my cognition that I sort of have conscious access to is this tiny little snippet of all this stuff going on, right? So kind of, you know, if I thought about it, I would have done like the iceberg with the way bigger iceberg underneath the water, right? You've got all this stuff going on, and then at the end of that whole process, you've got a little bit of an output, and then you decide how to reason about it, right? But sometimes that stuff that you don't have access to, that stuff that's sort of beneath or behind the dashboard, however you want to work it, is really, really important. And one group of people that, well, whether they knew this specifically or not, they certainly learned how to exploit it, were the people that came up with the idea of bringing the dessert cart out when they ask you if you want dessert. Right? So there's two ways you can do this, right? If I run a restaurant, I can just ask you if you want dessert, and I can offer you a description of all the things, and I can even show you pictures, which would be better. But I could tell you all the stuff that's available for dessert, and I could let you make a rational decision, right? Or I could put the food in front of you, right? Now, what that does, right, if we're thinking about sort of above and below the dashboard processing, it may turn out that as soon as you see the food, there are immediate responses, cognitive responses that are directly linked to behavior, right? That sort of primitive want, right? And the decision settled before you consciously make it, right? So your body has already sort of done the work of, okay, we're having the dessert. And then conscious you Well, you deliberate, you hum and hawing, look at the price and stuff like that. But the question is, well, is that humming and hawing actually playing a role in what you do, or are you just rationalizing what you were going to do anyway? Right? And I think frequently, that higher order cognition, right, all the stuff that we think is logic and reason and stuff like that, is devoted as much towards just making sense of the stuff that more basic processes were already sort of pushing us to do. Okay? I don't think that's always the case, but I think it happens a lot more than we think. Okay? Here's a little more sophisticated way, right? So this comes from, again, Daniel Kahneman, who we're going to see a lot of today. The dual system theory. And so this is how it works, is you've got two separate information processing systems operating in your brain. Okay? System one and system two. System one is, well, let's start with system two because it's the one that you're most sort of intimately familiar with. System two is your deliberator. This is the one that reflects. It does it reasons. It's logical. It's the one that you're conscious of. When I ask you to provide reasons for your behavior, justify yourself, right? Explain yourself. That's system two, right? You're working through things in your head, and that's the sort of highfalutin, high-powered cognitive stuff, okay? Now, it's high-powered, but it's costly. It's energetically costly. It's really slow. It takes a lot of effort to get it going. It's exhausting. Okay, if you had to think deliberately about everything you did, say just for your morning routine, you would be just beat before you got to work. Okay, it would be really, really hard. Nature understands this, which is why we evolved two different systems. Okay, so system two is your deliberator, but system one's handling a lot of the work. System one's our associationistic coper. So it's our pattern completer. It's fast, it's frugal, it picks out just, you know, relations between things really quickly. It's knowing how rather than sort of declarative or declarative knowledge, these kinds of things. And it's intimately connected to action, okay? And it's connected to behavior a lot more closely than this kind of what we'd call decoupled system two process, okay? And most importantly is it works kind of beneath the dashboard. It's not processing that we're actually conscious of. Now, there's relationships between these two things. System one sets the context that system two operates within. And system two can, with a little bit of work, influence what system one does. But it's hard. And if you don't know that these systems exist at all, you're really prone to get them mixed up. Because all you know is what you do and why you think you do it, regardless of what's actually driving you. So let's talk about a couple cases, right? What I'm going to do is just throw a whole bunch of different cases at you and kind of just let you realize that we may not think the way we think we think. This is the implicit association test, and you are all encouraged to go take this. So it's at implicit.harvard.edu, and you can play with it. You give them a little bit of information, and you can play around with it. They have lots and lots of different tests for different kinds of race, for gender, for occupation. There's all kinds of different things like that. But they're all involved this sort of association sort of test, right? So you put your left finger over here and your right finger over here, and it's one of those things where when you see the stuff pop up on the screen, you either tap left or tap right. In the case of the implicit association test, so this is the one, I pulled up the one for race, what you get are African-American faces and white faces, and you get good and bad, okay? So over in this case, right, over here, you get the mix of, say, European or bad, and African-American or good, and faces or words will flash on the screen, right? And your job is to categorize them, okay? So it'll be a combination of African-American faces and white faces and then various words, right? Good words, joy, love, peace, wonderful. Bad words are things like agony, horrible, nasty, evil, failure, things like that, right? And the question is, well, how quickly can you correctly categorize the things that you see on the screen? When, for example, in this sort of case, if it's European-American and good and African-American and bad, are you a little bit faster at categorizing than if you mix them, European-American and bad and African-American and good? And the idea is that it might turn out that your reaction times are a little bit slower in that second case, right? Or maybe in the other way around, right, depending. And the idea is that by looking at those sort of reaction times, right, looking at when your sort of, you know, system one processes get their wires crossed, you're going to be able to figure out your implicit preferences for things, right? Never mind your explicit preferences, the preferences that you actually tell people you have, and even the preferences that you sort of endorse consciously, but the kinds of preferences that are already sort of built into you as a system before you get around to doing any sort of deliberation or reasoning. And they've posted all their papers. You're welcome to look through them, but just a quick sort of, you know, a smorgasbord of results. White U.S. citizens tend to have negative implicit attitudes towards both non-white Americans and foreigners. Non-white groups tend to have negative attitudes towards other non-white groups. Swedish employers have strongly negative implicit attitudes towards Arab Muslims and implicitly judge them as less productive than native Swedes. U.S. physician results reveal implicit preferences favoring white Americans and implicit stereotypes of black Americans as less cooperative patients. And best of all, thinking about a single criminal suspect automatically increases negative implicit attitudes towards an entire group. We generalize very quickly and we do it unconsciously. Now, the best part of all of this is that that's implicit, right? That's what we're pulling out of the click data, right? It doesn't track what people say on the surveys, right? So you can have someone that thinks, I'm very tolerant and open-minded and I think everyone should be equal, but you can find hidden biases kind of lurking under the surface. Okay? And I'm not saying that they're good or bad. I don't think that you can be judged for them because you probably don't have a lot of control over them, but it's really important to know that they're there. More stuff. So there's a handful of researchers that are really interested in behavioral immune responses. So everyone's got an immune system, right? You're familiar with that, and it keeps pathogens from, you know, turning your guts to liquid. And it does a pretty good job of dealing with the stuff that gets into your body, right? But one thing that a lot of people are interested in is, well, animals also use a lot of behaviors to sort of help that out, right? For example, you don't defecate where you eat, right? Things like that. And animals know this instinctively. This is a way that sort of the sort of self-protective function of the immune system gets sort of borne out through behavior as well. And so what a handful of folks are really interested in is are things like patriotism and xenophobia a form of, admittedly a misguided, but a form of this sort of behavioral immune response. So what do? Well, you gross people out and then you see if they become more racist. Right. So here's one example of it. So people that are primed with things like accidents, right, so reminding them about the risk of electrocution and earthquakes and slipping and falling and things like that, versus priming them with things like really gross clumps of hair and feces and dirty sponges and stuff like that, and then testing them on, if they were in charge of a country, how much money would they donate to refugees from different kinds of countries? It's a cool way to kind of quantify it, right? How much money would you give to this? In the studies that we get here, well, when it's accidents that are salient, when we're reminding people about just regular old accidents, well, there's a difference, but it's not really statistically significant, okay? They're within range of each other. It's not a big deal. When you start reminding them of pathogens and disease, all of a sudden things start changing. In particular, this is the bar for how much you would allocate to familiar immigrants versus unfamiliar ones. And what the leaders of the study suggest is, well, the idea is that we've got this sort of built-in thing that people that aren't like me carry different germs, right? Whether they do or not, it's irrelevant, right? We're interested in not in rational processes, but in irrational or irrational processes. And the concern is, you've got that operating in the background too, right? Influencing your behavior a little bit. And again, if you don't correct for it, it might kind of start nudging you. Another one that I thought was funny is that women in the first trimester of pregnancy seem to be way, way xenophobic. This is one study, and I don't necessarily stand behind it, but it's an interesting idea. And that because in the first trimester of pregnancy, well, this is when the mother and the fetus are both most susceptible to disease. And so they showed these women different stories written by, American, you know, born kids and foreign kids writing about different things, and you ask them to judge the people on the basis of their essays, right? And weirdly enough, in the first trimester, women seem to really prefer in-group to out-group, okay? Things tend to level off afterwards. Now again, that's a non-rational factor that's influencing a rational decision-making, right? It's influencing our conscious attitudes, even though we don't know they are. But maybe you want to say, okay, fine, whatever. I've got all this gross stuff sort of that's undermining my judgment, but it's okay because I am deep down a logical being, and so I can use the power of reason to sort of suppress all of this, right? And so the next thing I want to show you is that we're not logical. This is the waste and selection task, and we'll play it. I won't make anyone raise hands, right? I'm embarrassing students is fine, but you're here for a good reason. But here's the story, right? So we lay out these cards, right? Each card has a number on one side and a color on the other side. And here's the rule that the cards are supposed to follow. I'm not sure how cards follow rules, but whatever. If the card has an even number on one side, its opposite side is red. Okay? And what you ask subjects is, flip, how many cards do you need to flip over to find out if that rule is being followed and which ones, right? If I flip all the cards over, right, it's kind of a no-brainer, right? So flipping as few cards over as possible, which ones do you flip to determine whether or not the rule, if the card has an even number on one side, its opposite side is red. Okay. I'll give you all a second. B, C. See, I wasn't going to call anyone out, but you're volunteering. B, C, D. It's only two cards. Okay. If a card has an even number on one side, its opposite side is red. The one I need to look at, well, the two I need to look at are B and D. Okay. Why? Well, it's an if-then statement. Right? And the only way if-then statements are true, are false, right, which my logicians also know, is that the first part's got to be true and the second part's going to be false. Right? That's the only way. So how do I tell if this rule is being followed? If the card has an even number on one side, the opposite side is red. Well, first thing I need to do is I need to check the one with an even number and see what the color is on the opposite side, right, to make sure it's being broken. I don't care if it's got an odd number. My rule's not about odd numbers. It's about even numbers, right? And if the card has an even number on one side, its opposite side is red. I don't care about the red card. Other numbers can have red backs. That's no big deal. That's not my problem. But what I do care about is this blue card over here to see whether or not it's got an even number on the other side. Right? So I flip over those two cards. Now, people are really, really bad at that task. Okay? But watch this. Here's a different rule. If a patron is drinking beer, then they must be 21. Who do I have to check? I check the person with the beer to make sure that they're over 21, and I check the 16-year-old. Now, you all see that this is exactly the same task. But when it's about abstract concepts, we're terrible at it. And when it's about rule following in familiar social situations, suddenly we're fine. Right? Now, what this tells me, right, and what it's suggested to other people, is that when I'm reasoning about stuff, even in this case, right, if this, then that, right, is like logic 101, right? Because the material conditional is one of the first things we talk about. It shouldn't matter what it's about. It's if P, then Q, and here's how it comes out false. Whatever I plug in for P and Q shouldn't matter if what I'm actually doing is logical reasoning, right? If, for example, reason amounts to sort of the operations of a general purpose engine that just churns up whatever material you feed it, our performance should be exactly the same on these tasks, but it's not. So what that suggests is, well, I'm not doing that. I'm doing something else when I reason about this stuff. And this gets to sort of a difference in the way that we think about how we think. So one way of thinking about cognition is, well, the superhuman version, right? We're sort of ideal, rational deliberators, or at least we are in our best case. We're better or worse cognitive agents insofar as we approximate to that sort of abstract ideal. Okay? We are, you know, in our best form, you know, computers. Here's the other way to look at it. We're a messy collection of cognitive hacks. Right? We have all sorts of different tools that have been sort of sloppily assembled for the purpose of getting us around in the world long enough to reproduce. Right? So we're not computers, we're toolboxes, or Swiss Army knives is sometimes the other thing that people use. Right? You've got all sorts of different things, and they've got very specific functions. Sometimes they get used for the wrong job, but they're what we've evolved to have. Here's why this matters. Again, xenophobia is an irrational fear, right? Or an irrational hatred. And I suspect that what it has to do with is, well, it depends on our sort of figuring out the likelihood of terrorist attacks or likelihoods of espionage, right? Oh, and so what are we doing? When I reason about these things, and people do reason about them, right? Whether they reason correctly or not. Oh, I'm computing probabilities in my head, right? I'm doing that kind of work. And we can calculate probabilities, right? We can take courses that help us to actually do it correctly. You can take stats, right? Students love stats. Because it's so natural and intuitive and easy for them. Right? We can do that stuff, right? The question is, do we, when we're actually reasoning through these kinds of really significant things in our heads, right? Most people, when they became xenophobic, they didn't sit down and put pen to paper, right? Those of us that aren't xenophobic didn't do it either, most likely. But nonetheless, we've got really strong opinions about it, right? So what's actually grounding these things? So let's compute probabilities. So here's the story. Linda is a 31-year-old woman who is single. She's considered outspoken and very bright. She majored in philosophy in college. As a student, she was deeply concerned with discrimination and social issues. She participated in several demonstrations. And the question is, what's more likely? Linda is a bank teller, or Linda is a bank teller and active in the feminist movement? we've got A. It has to be A. Here's why. Think in terms of sets. Okay? The set of feminist bank tellers is going to be smaller than the set of bank tellers. Right? The probability of the conjoint probability of two events is going to be lower than the probability of either one of them. Lots and lots of people get this one wrong. 80% of people get this wrong. Here's another one. Greg is a twice-divorced man who spends most of his free time at a country club. He regrets following in his father's footsteps. He wishes he hadn't spent so much time in college on academics and instead spent more time socializing, so he wouldn't be so quick to argue with people. Is he a lawyer? Oh, sorry. And we surveyed 70 engineers and 30 lawyers. I may have screwed up this time. What's more likely? Well, obviously you all got it right. What's more likely? He's a lawyer or he's an engineer? He's an engineer. Why? Well, it's look at the numbers here, right? So you surveyed 70 engineers and 30 lawyers. But weirdly enough, people go a lawyer, or at least when the example is presented correctly. You can do this in other cases, right? So you can say Joe is a big strapping man who's very wealthy and stuff like that, right? Is he a librarian or is he a professional football player? Never goes out, professional football player. Despite the fact that the proportion of professional football players to librarians is, right? So, when we're estimating likelihoods, we're not doing a very good job of computing probabilities, right? And sure enough, when these things are presented correctly, roughly 80% of respondents pick the wrong answer. Okay? Two possible answers to this. Just everyone's cognitively defective, right? Everyone's going to but maybe there's another answer, and that's that, well, we gave the wrong measure, right? They're failing at that task because they weren't trying to do that, right? They thought they were trying to do it, but they weren't, right? Maybe our brains are trying to do something very different than computing probabilities. So, and here's where heuristics come in. Heuristics are cognitive shortcuts that we use to decrease problem spaces and make computationally difficult tasks easier to manage, right? And our heuristics do it by cutting corners, right? By simplifying tasks, by relying on regularities in our environments and things like that. Lots and lots of little tricks to get good enough kind of answers, right? So heuristics don't get the right answer all the time, but they get it enough to be worth it, right? So here's one. The representativeness heuristic, right? And unfortunately, the people that discovered these things weren't very good at naming them, but this is what it's called. And representativeness works like this. The probability of an event is estimated relative to the degree to which that event is similar to a given stereotype. So in other words, when I calculate the probability of something, I don't actually crunch numbers. What I do is I get a picture in my head, and then I gauge probability by how close what you're telling me fits that picture, right? So, try it again. Linda's a 31-year-old woman who's single. She's outspoken, very bright, majored in philosophy. She's concerned with discrimination and social issues. She participated in several demonstrations. What's more plausible? Right. Well, now it makes a little more sense, right? Because the idea was something like this. Well, if Linda's this remarkable woman, if she's a bank teller, I bet she does even more, right? I bet she's involved in all sorts of things. She was an activist as a kid, or as a student, she's going to want to pursue that philosophy major, right? She's one of the liberated few. She's going to do all this wonderful stuff. But look what I'm doing. As soon as I do that, I'm importing all this additional stuff into the story that has nothing to do with the statistical likelihood of what Linda is, right? I'm telling stories now, and I'm building that story based on some assumptions that I'm making on the basis of the data that you gave me. And the issue is that sometimes the assumptions might not be quite so benign. Another example. So the cozy hamlet of Exampleville is served by two hospitals. And in the large hospital, about 45 babies are born each day, and in the smaller one, about 15 babies are born each day. As you know, or as we will assume, about 50% of all babies are boys. However, the exact percentage varies from day to day. Sometimes it may be higher than 50%, sometimes lower. For a period of 1 year, each hospital recorded the number of days on which over 60% of the babies born were boys. Which hospital do you think recorded more of such days? More days where the number of boys born, or the percentage of boys born, was greater than 60%. The larger, the smaller, or about the same?
Large.
Okay. Everyone's quietly murmuring their answer. It's B. Right. Now, most people people, right? And in the study here, you've got 21 kind of split evenly, but the vast majority of people say C. Why? Well, it's a 50-50 shot, so who cares how many? Right? It could be big, big, small, whatever the size of it is. But the problem with that, right, is that, no, the size matters a lot, right? So if I flip a coin one time, I'm going to get 100% heads rate or a 100% tails rate. If I flip it twice, I still got a pretty good chance, right? If I flip it a million times, it's going to probably, you know, we're going to get a little bit, or, you know, something a little bit closer to the mean. So why is this representativeness? Well, we take small chunks of data as representative of the way big chunks are going to go, right? Another word, the sort of fallacy that's associated with this is sometimes known as the hasty generalization, right? So I can take small sample size and I assume that because of this sample size, this percentage of people were this way. Well, I assume that, well, when the sample's this way, it's going to be exactly the same. And what sort of data am I taking? Well, my data comes from my informational environment, right? The kinds of things that I see not just in person, but on TV, things I hear about on the radio, things I find out about on the internet, and so on. So, what do I have? Most foreigners I've heard of are dangerous people, so I have good reason to specifically associate foreigners with danger. This is the heuristic talking, right? Sort of in the background. And the problem is, well, there's lots of problems once you sort of expose this kind of thinking, right? There's an insensitivity to sample size. How many foreign people have you actually met, right? There's a what they call a pseudo-diagnosticity bias. Well, the percentage of dangerous foreigners to dangerous non-foreigners. Did you consider the looming Polish threat, right? You know, things like that. There's also okay, fine. A non-negligible percentage of Middle Easterners are violent, but guess what? Non-Middle Easterners are violent too. And then on top of it, there's this insensitivity to selection bias, right? Because the lower down parts of your brain don't care whether you saw it in person or on TV, right? So yeah, sure enough, most of the Middle Eastern people I've seen have been violent. Why? Because I watch the news a lot. And most of the things like Middle Eastern people, just like non-Middle Eastern people do, are boring and not newsworthy, right? I walk around this campus all the time and I see all sorts of Syrian students just reading. Right? That doesn't get on TV. So when we think about sort of my environment, what I get are lots and lots of information of people doing really bad things. And again, consciously I recognize, okay, fine, there's a selection bias, right? But the point is that your brain doesn't always recognize that, even if consciously you do. Okay, more stuff. So representativeness, along the same lines, availability. We tend to assign more weight to information that's easier for us to retrieve. Okay? So, right, you put the thing you use most in the front of the filing cabinet, right? That sort of thing. If I can recall it quickly, it must be important, right? Some more examples, right? What's a more likely cause of death in the United States? Falling airplane parts or shark attacks? Right. You are 30 times more likely to die from falling airplane parts. Or at least you were in 1990 when the study was conducted. Maybe sharks could be more dangerous. But, well, why is this? Well, because falling airplane parts, that's a really weird thing, right? It's really unusual. Where shark attacks, right? We have movies about that, right? One good one and lots of bad ones. So sure enough, this is in the public consciousness more. You're exposed to it more, and so that information becomes easier to retrieve. And when you start thinking about what's more likely, you pull from the front of the filing cabinet. You can do the same thing for auto accidents versus stomach cancer, which kills a lot more people than auto accidents do. Tornadoes versus lightning strikes. You don't have lightning strike drills. You don't have lightning strike watches and warnings. You do have thunderstorm watches and warnings. But in general, tornadoes we think are much more dangerous, right? But lightning strikes actually kill more people than tornadoes do. Next bit. Vividness. So related here, right? Not only is if I think about it more, it must be more important. The other bit is if it's got some emotional sort of heft to it, it must be more important, right? So I want to buy a car, and I look at consumer reports, and I crunch numbers and all this stuff, and I say, okay, I figure out what car I want to get. I want to buy the Hyundai Elantra or something like that, and then I hear that my sister had a Hyundai Elantra and it was a lemon. Well, that's it. Right? On the basis of one anecdotal case, I throw out all my hard work. Right? And it's a really common thing, right? Things that are emotionally salient, we give them more weight, whether we want to or not. By the way, you can do the same thing here in legal cases. A bunch of subjects, right? So the idea, we're going to argue that this guy, was driving drunk, right? So the prosecution the prosecution in this fake case, says, well, on the way out the door, Smith staggered against a serving table, knocking a bowl to the floor, right? And that's all you say. And the second one, you spend a lot of time talking about the guacamole and the carpet, Okay? You add detail, you make it vivid, right? Now, it turns out that that doesn't influence juror decisions at all in the moment. But if you give it 48 hours, it has an enormous effect. Why? Because it enters into their deliberative processes, and, well, it's still there because it's anchored with all this detail, right? All this salient stuff, right? You know, guacamole on white shag carpet. It's got to be white shag carpet, right? Or carpet, right? It's got to be like something like visceral and, you know, painful. And it sticks with you. And then when it comes time for you to be rational and reasonable, what materials do you use? Well, sure enough, this emotionally salient stuff's right in front and center. Okay. Yeah, I've got a little bit of time. So, give y'all one last sort of set of examples here. So you're in charge of the country now. Congratulations. And the first thing you have to deal with is there's a disease. It's coming. It's going to be very bad. And you need to adopt one of these two programs. So if program A is adopted, 200 people will be saved. And if program B is adopted, there will be a 1/3 chance that 600 people will be saved and 2/3 probability that no one will be saved. Okay. So just to yourself, choose your program. Okay. I don't know, everyone died. You're in charge of a new country now. And someone gives you these, again, the disease is coming, and you have to choose one of these two plans, C or D. If program C is adopted, 400 people will die, and if program D is adopted, there's a 1/3 probability that nobody will die, and a 2/3 probability that 600 people will die. Okay, so now the question, which one of these do you want to choose? Okay, so everybody's got answers. And this is what we get, right? So when we talk about it this way, 72% of people choose program A, only 28% like program B, 22% like program C, 78% like program D. And of course, the funny thing about this is that A and C are the exact same program, B and D are the exact same program, right? The only difference is whether the story is framed or explained in terms of saved versus lost. And as soon as we frame the problem in terms of loss, we get really antsy about it, right? If it's in terms of potential gains, we're all right. And again, you can think about this, right? If you're thinking about a brain that privileges adaptivity over rationality, you don't want to lose your last bit of food, right? It'd be great if you could get more food, but you definitely don't want to starve. Okay? And so sure enough, people are incredibly loss averse. Okay, so what I wanted to do is just give you a smorgasbord of cognitive mechanisms that function, first of all, automatically, second of all, unconsciously, and third of all, in a way that's linked directly to behavior. Okay, and also that feeds our deliberative faculties with the raw materials that they need to make our highly rational deliberative judgments. Okay, so we've got this behavioral immune response, possibly. We associate unfamiliar people with disease and sickness. Implicit bias, we automatically form negative associations about people different from us. Representativeness, even when we think we're intuiting probabilities, we're actually judging by stereotype. Availability, we assign additional weight to information that's easy to retrieve. We assign additional weight to vivid, emotionally violent, salient information. We're affected more by the prospect of loss than the prospect of gain. Now the question is, how would an organism with this particular cognitive makeup respond to the prospect of foreign immigration after a terrorist attack? And so when you know about this stuff, right, xenophobia is not shocking. It's sad, but it's not shocking. If anything, I'm surprised there aren't more, right? Because there's a sense in which we're really wired to close ranks in the face of this kind of threat, even though it's immoral, even though it's irrational, okay? Our brains aren't made for morality and rationality, or at least not for rationality. Okay, so we have these heuristics. Why? Right? They seem to be terrible. Well, again, just to recap, the reason we have them in the first place is that they're usually right, okay? And they allow for adaptive behavior in information-rich, chaotic environments, okay? But the catch is that they're tailored to the environments that they were evolved within, right? They helped us negotiate a very particular sort of environment, and the problem is our environments have changed dramatically, right? Our cultural world is changing far faster than evolution can keep pace with, right? Especially now that we've got this whole new informational landscape afforded to us by media, our TV, radio, the internet, stuff like that, right? So, two worries that I want to sort of bring up. The first is what's sometimes known as epistemic closure. Epistemic closure is the idea that I can pretty much tailor the informational landscape around me to whatever I want, right? So, whatever I believe, I can find the news network that supports it. I can pick my friends on Facebook, and if even if I'm being a little open-minded, Facebook has algorithms that will tailor things to me, right, based on what I like and what I don't like, right? Because what they want to do is keep me looking at my feed. I don't have to talk to anyone I disagree with if I don't want to, right? Or if I do, I can immediately run back to the other people that share my beliefs so I can talk about what an idiot that guy was, right? It's really easy to do, and in fact, it's really comforting, right, to know that you're not alone in the world, right? No matter where you are, thanks to the internet, you can find a community of people that believe exactly what you believe and will support you. And it's at the cost of insulating ourselves from difference, right? Insulating ourselves from things in the world that might challenge our views. The other thing is we've got one additional cognitive mechanism that I'm really fond of bringing up, which is this notion of confirmation bias, and then it's kind of brother or sister bias, however you want to call it, disconfirmation bias. Confirmation bias works like this. I'm way more receptive to information that supports what I already believe. I'm way more critical of things that don't support what I already believe, right? Again, social media, right? This is all over the place, right? Somebody posts a meme in favor of character X, and you say, oh, that's not just false, it's obviously false. How could you be so dumb, right? I'll Snopes it, I'll do all the things that need to be done, right, to show you that this is wrong, right? You go into this sort of hypercritical mode, right? You're not gonna show what's wrong with this, right? But then, how many of us, right, again, you don't have to raise your hands, I'll raise it for you, have gotten suckered in exactly that way, where I was like, oh, yeah, hell yeah, right? This is exactly how it works. And then someone steps in and says, you realize that, well, that's all false, right? Or the statistics don't even show that. Or the graph is bad or something like that. It's like, ooh, rats, yeah. I let that slide, right? So it's good that I had people to point it out towards me, right? I wish they'd be nicer about it. But the idea is that we're sort of wired to take things, right? Again, I want to build these coherent pictures of the world in my head. I take things that fit what's already in there, right? Coherence is more important to me than sort of capital T truth a lot of times. Now, what does this mean? I've got two filters that are keeping me feeling awfully secure, right? So even if the world is flat out telling me I'm wrong, I can organize my environment in ways to where I can sort of exclude some of that, right? Oh, well, you know, what that turns into is, well, somebody thinks I'm wrong, right? And I go back to my epistemic community and I say, can you believe that guy, right? But even that stuff that gets through, well, if it fits my worldview, I accept it uncritically. If it doesn't fit my worldview, then I drop the hammer on, right? I'm very critical. And so even when the world is screaming at me, you're wrong, by the end of it, I can say, hey, I got it right. Good for me. Right? I'm still a good person. Just ask me. Okay. So just a couple things real quick here. So the thing that I've tried to get across right is this idea that we've got all these automatic unconscious mechanisms that are predisposing us to xenophobia. Okay. One question, right, that, you know, if you're interested in morality, is, well, if I can't control it, I can't really be judged for it, right? I should be blamed for the things that I intentionally do. It looks like all of this is happening under the hood. Why can I blame xenophobes? And I want to say, well, yeah, you can. Maybe you can't be held responsible for having the kinds of gut feelings that you do, okay? The one thing I want to get on the table, right, is everyone's a little bit xenophobic and a little bit racist, okay? And it's probably healthy to accept that fact, right? Because if you feel embarrassed about it, you're more likely to lie to yourself about it, and that might lead to problems down the road. So it's probably better to recognize, look, we have these reactions, right? We tense up when we're around people that we are not familiar with, that people that are unlike us. So we can't be really held responsible for that, at least I don't think we can. But we can be really, we can be held responsible with what we do after that. Okay? So I can't choose my gut feelings, but I can choose whether to endorse them or reject them, right? For example, I can be aware that, hey, I've got this feeling, but I recognize the fact that I'm wired up to have these kinds of feelings in these situations, and they're bad feelings to have. My feelings are sometimes wrong, right? The person that thinks that everything they feel is exactly the right thing to feel at that time is a very dangerous person to be around, right? Because I hope they don't start feeling the wrong stuff. So it's important for us to exercise this faculty of metacognition, recognize that even if I have these kinds of gut-level intuitive responses, emotional responses, I can monitor them and say, well, this seems like the right thing to do right now, but does it really sort of fit with the sort of world that I want to sort of contribute to? I can mitigate the risk of epistemic closure by actually actively seeking out difference in the world, right? It means that I can't wait for the difference to come to me because I'm very bad at it. And by the way, the other different elements of the world are, well, they've got the same problems I do, right? So I have to kind of seek it out. I have to recognize that I'm prone to surrounding myself with like-minded people and force myself to be in the presence of others, right? With kind of a capital O. I can recognize the selection bias inherent in my media. It's going to filter out a lot of stuff that's going to lead me to make weird probable likelihood judgments. I can acknowledge that the conscious awareness that xenophobia is wrong is not enough to prevent xenophobia, right? Virulent racists will quite a lot of racists will say, yeah, I know racism is wrong, if you ask them. But then they'll go back to doing racist stuff. Xenophobia is the same way. Nobody thinks xenophobia is a good idea, right? But nobody thinks they're a xenophobe. Why? Well, because in my case, I'm doing the right thing. Yeah, they were wrong, but this is about safety, people. Right? So realizing that just being able to say it's wrong and being able to consciously endorse that fact doesn't cure you. It doesn't prevent you from going down that path. Furthermore, I can be aware that I am, in part, a bundle of adaptive mechanisms that are geared towards adaptive success, not reason and morality, and sometimes they're going to do weird stuff, and I need to be aware of that, and I need to be prepared to override them. So, that's how we inoculate ourselves, maybe against bad ideas, and maybe be slightly less awful. So, thank you.
12, and if you have any more, please send them down and we'll grab them for you. Thank you so much. That was absolutely amazing. We have a couple of questions related to racism and xenophobia. So if we're looking at Syrians, and most of them are kind of Caucasian and they look really similar to us, how does that basis go underneath just the appearance and go into religion, or how did they become the other when at first glance they might appear the same?
I don't know. I mean, I think for one thing, there's a tendency to lump a lot of people under the same sort of category, right? So we've got this sort of stereotype of sort of the average Middle Eastern person, which is maybe an amalgam of every Middle Eastern person that you've ever seen in person and on the news and that's painting with a huge broad brush, right? There was a thing about Reza Aslan. Laid into a reporter a while ago talking about Islam and, Muslims are like this and like that. And he said, well, which ones, right? the Turkey ones in Iran? Like, there's a massive difference, right? But they all get sort of lumped into a single category. And so, I imagine you have a lot of people that say, I would never let Syrians into my company or into my country. And then you said, which of these three people is Syrian? I bet they, this is speculation, but I'm guessing they wouldn't know. Part of that just has to do with a lack of exposure to the, to real people. So that's the best guess.
Do any of you want to comment on that at all? Also, we have a microphone for people can't hear in the back. Sorry, I forgot to turn it off. Okay. So most of the U.S. population must be xenophobic in some ways, as we spoke of, based on how media portrays its guardianship over news and information. So how do we overcome that?
Well, I was going to say, I'm acutely aware of the fact that if I start answering all the questions, I will never stop talking. I suppose one of the main takeaways from this that I hope to get across is that what we have to do is constantly remind ourselves of the fact that this bias exists, right? So, fighting your own psychology and fighting those sorts of media structures that feed into it is hard work, right? And it takes sort of constant vigilance, I think getting comfortable is the problem. And so I don't know of a way other than to just constantly remind yourself that what you're getting isn't representative of the actual world, or to demand better from your media. But I can't say that I have solutions for how to do that.
So that's on a personal level. What about could we influence other people who aren't aware of all of these?
Well, I hope so. Go tell everyone.
Make them aware.
Yeah, if all of this is right, it is pervasive, right? And it's something that people do need to know. And they are things that can be overridden deliberately. We're not slaves to our own brains. It's something that's going to need some work, and people need to know there's a problem before they can solve it.
I don't know if that's actually one.
So one other way that we can do is to filter the things that we get from the media.
So whenever we hear a story and we hear something from people about a specific subject regarding stereotyping and prejudices, then we need to take the further step, not just accept it as it is and take the comfortable way, but just take the next step of searching for the real truth in that story. So it will be not as comfortable as accepting it as it is, but it will be the necessary step if you wanna become accurate, if you wanna make an accurate decision, accurate judgment. You need to take the further step in determining the validity of this of what you hear in the news or wherever you hear.
Well, for me, I think I can imagine that the average person, especially in the United States, is on a busy schedule, whether he's a college student or a kid person working all day, wherever he is. So one of the easiest ways to receive your information is just look at TV screen and just say this is correct, because it follows a logical pattern, just like John's just said. And then again, it's too hard for people to spend a lot of time researching to get to the truth. Because mainly it does take time. If you want to look at a billion sources to confirm each piece of information you hear, it does take effort. So if you find yourself in a situation, at least that's my opinion, that you're receiving something that is compelling to believe from a huge source such as a media group like Fox News, for example, we can at least base the person giving us this information is not non-biased. He also has an agenda. They also want to give an idea. And that way, we can very basically take out a couple of information and say, they're saying this because they want us to believe such and such. It's not the most effective way, but it's a very basic way, at least for me, just to know that somebody's saying this because not because they want to inform us, because they want some people to think so. Yeah.
There was another question about what we could do on the government level or politically. Do any of you have opinions on that?
What aspect?
On how to combat xenophobia or these constructs that we do.
So there's always like the first part that we need to take the step to educate people more about ourselves and make people aware of that issue. That, as the professor said, if they have no idea who we are and how we look like and what our culture looks like, we did not expose them to it. It's our responsibility to let them know about it and explain more about it. The second part is for the government and for the social structures in the society. They need to help us deliver that message. Whoever understands that message and know that there are wrong things that are being said to people, then they need to take the further step again and just support the people who want to do something to change the wrong ideas that exist already in society. So I think that's what governments and the social structures need to do about it.
Okay.
Wait,
I'm wondering, because like you guys probably, I wonder if you experience this, like, do people come up to you and say, oh, you're Syrian? Like, you're not Syrian, are you? You're just whatever, something else, because we know you, you're great. And I think this is, even as these ambassadors are in our midst, showing this little community here at U of E or Evansville or however you want to say it, that, hey, we have similar value structures and morality and everything else, people are looking at them and saying, oh, but you're not who we're talking about. And how do you combat that? And I guess this was, to me, perfectly, the whole Beyonce thing with the formation video and then the Saturday Night Live skit where the day the world found out that Beyonce was black, and when the woman is in the streets of New York and she's saying to her black friend, oh my God, Beyonce's black, and she's like, oh my God, she's like, no, you're my girl. And then she's like, no, I'm black. She's like, that guy's black. And then the guy with the hoodie, oh yeah, he's black, but you, Okay, see, this is like, how did you overcome that?
Well, I love it when people come to me and they're like, you know, I heard you were Syrian, but I thought you were Brazilian or... Is that true? Are you really Syrian? Like, you know, or something? I know, I sensed an accent, but I wasn't able to tell. And first, it makes me proud, obviously, that, you know, someone... It makes me proud of that person because I also do that in a way where, you know, all the stuff that we hear, you know, I feel like the best way we can try to understand each other is to have those communications. And that's what we've done, taking a huge step here tonight, coming here and putting ourselves in, honestly, somewhat, you know, an uncomfortable seat, you know, to hear about an uncomfortable, maybe topic, a topic that is very, you know, controversial, especially today. So I love when people come in and do that, and I try to do that too, to learn from people, just to, you know, I try to find people that support Donald Trump all the time, you know, I want to talk to them. I don't want Donald Trump to represent them, or I don't want Hillary Clinton to represent those people. I want to go on, I want to hear what they have to say, because when you break that border, when we break that kind of ice that is between us, you get to hear from the real source, and you try to understand, you know, where are those opinions coming from, and you know, you just get it from where you should need to hear it, and then it's just, it has amazed me since I've been here in the United States how much I've changed my perspective and grown my perspective about the American people. When I was back in Syria, you know, we've been talking a lot about the U.S. trying to understand other cultures and other people, but it's also the other way around. You know, back home, I know that we're the Democrats and Republicans, but I never knew. You know, we think, or at least me, I thought that they're all on the same page. They seem to get along or something like that. They're all laughing. Yeah, really. I come here, and oh my God. What are those? You know, debates. Is this an actual political debate? Imagine when you're up to the, you know, final. You have a Democrat and a Republican on that stage. What's going to happen? So it's just breaking that ice and trying to communicate. And I always love it when people ask me, "Are you Syrian? And what's going on in your country?" You know, I've heard something, and even if that person thinks Syria is in Europe, which has happened many times. But it just breaking that and starting those communications are really, really effective.
Yeah, also, things happen to me when I tell people there are Syrian doctors here. And they say, like, really, there are Syrian doctors in this city? So the stereotype, it's all about personal decision. And when we decide to know more, we will know more. So we need to, like, every person need to review his process of thinking. And as the professor said again, and we know that we have these ideas, these stereotypes in our minds, but we really need to check them again every time we use them. So it's a personal choice that needs to be taken to get exposed to the Syrians, to the Syrian people, or whatever population that's being discriminated against. And just when we allow people to know more and decide their personal choice, then they will change. Because if you force ideas on people, that will never work. If they are not convinced from inside that, okay, I see that the majority of those people are good people, then what I'm being fed by the media or by whoever is feeding me the information, then I get to understand and really become convinced of that fact. So that's what I think.
Yes. Also, what you said regarding the Beyonce video, that shows the gap between what the media just views as, for example, black people, and what it views as Syrian people. So what you said about people coming up and asking us if we're Syrian, that shows the serious gap between what is true and what the media is just publicizing, if you want to say that. And that gap shows who's interested in knowing and who isn't. So if you're aware that some people might go up and search, for example, online, it's that simple. You can just type a few letters on your phone and you'll get your answers. Who's interested in exactly knowing what's going on and what is true and what is not, without following behind the footprints of the media. It's very easy to cut your answers. It's just a question of whether you're interested enough or not.
Good point. Have you ever experienced someone being like, well, why don't you wear a hijab or something like that?
Yeah, that happens a lot. it's really bad. So here's the thing. Most people think since I'm a Muslim girl, I should be wearing a hijab. That is a completely personal choice. And that does not mean that I'm not a good Muslim. And that does not mean that I don't respect hijabi girls. And that's just my personal choice, and it depends on when I'm completely convinced with the point of hijab, which I am, but I'm just not there yet. So that's just a personal choice, and that does not affect me or affect my religion. Just because I'm not wearing the hijab, that does not mean that girls who aren't wearing the hijab aren't good girls or good Muslims, and that does not mean that girls who do wear the hijab aren't good human beings just because they're perceived as Muslim girls who are like extremists or anything of the sort.
Just to highlight on the previous question, I think it's really magical how exposure can break stereotypes, and like how people with very fundamental discriminatory ideas just break down if they actually met a person. But just like you said, you have these people who meet people from different cultures, and yet they have this idea that foreigners are still different. So on our behalf as Syrians, we feel we have a responsibility making programs like these to tell the world who we are and what's going on. But at the end of the day, it takes a personal dedication for you to choose open-mindedness over being a discriminator.
But I mean, it's about saying, hey, we're not the exception. We are Syrian.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And like,
we're not like some odd Syrian that just happens to be Americanized.
Exactly. And especially our community, the University of Evansville, we're Syrians from different classes and different places all over Syria. And like Basa is a Palestinian Syrian, I'm from Aleppo, our friend Amir is a Christian Syrian, and yet, even after exposure, you still have people that this kind of closed-mindedness. So I think as much as we do, at the end of the day, a person has a choice if they want to actually break the barriers and think to logic.
Yeah.
Oh,
wait, hold on,
you
have one more.
I have a quick question, and it kind of goes back kind of to the media, but so I guess Princeton did a study 4 or 5 years ago, talking about learners, people who learn, how they learn, the preference of learning. So you had oral learners, you had those that preferred to, were literary learners and oral, and then just strictly literary, they just like to read. And they found in the United States that it's like 53% of people were functionally illiterate. So they were predominantly oral learners. So what you tell them is how they remember. They're not going to read in the book. Then there was like a 46% that was functionally literate, but they preferred to be told what to do, like told information. And then it was like 11% that was just truly literary people. And so you've got media circles that are telling people what to learn, what to know, and how to perceive and digest that information. I learned a ton just now from this lecture that you gave, things that I was not even really aware of or even be able to put words to. And so, you know, this is an institution of higher learning. You have a lot of people here who have either gone to college or are attending college. Majority of people aren't going to college yet or aren't even college material per se. That they it's not their thing. So outside of maybe the school system at the primary level of educating kids at a very young level and having some influence, what do we do with the majority of functionally illiterate people who aren't going to do the research, aren't going to go out of their way because they've got, like you were saying, they've got their circles to justify their understanding? How do you break such a huge overarching, I mean, especially right now, I mean, we're in a very terrible time, I believe, just because we're going through this election cycle, and oh my gosh, and it's just amazing because I work in a physical therapy clinic. And so I get all kinds of grouping of people. And I had one individual who was just talking. I said, you know, I'm just curious. There's a few people in there. Any Trump supporters in the room? And one individual said, oh, yeah, man, we're going to do that. It was just fascinating to me, like, to hear him, because it sounds so irrational and he's speaking, but boy, he has got great conviction. So you got people who have this great conviction. How do you overcome the majority of the United States? And granted, that's just a picture snapshot of the United States. We've got other countries that have their own issues at the same time to deal with. Outside of the school systems and primary education and doing that and having people like you influencing kids, how do we break that?
I joked to a friend earlier that it's the most sort of just obnoxiously academic thing to say. We have this problem. Don't worry, we're going to have a lecture series. What else would professors do, right? But I think it's a real issue, and I mean the closest thing to an answer that I can come up with, right, is that. Those people, even if they're not literate, if they're not terribly reflective, if they're, and by the way, I thought the question was going to go somewhere else, and I'm going to talk about the difference between writing and just oral communication and how writing actually sort of pushes us towards deliberation, because you can return to the stuff on the page, it's there, whereas if you're listening to the radio, you let it wash over you, it's one thing over the next, and the things you remember aren't necessarily the most reasonable or rational. It's what you could remember, right? Which might be the funniest thing or the most emotionally jarring thing or what rhymed or whatever. As far as changing attitudes, I mean the good thing about all this, right? So we're these bundles of adaptive mechanisms. They're responsive to a particular environment, to include the social environment. The hope is that if we can make changes to that environment, people will adapt to it. Now, how are we supposed to do that? Well, I mean, possibly through, obviously, exposing people to more and more folks, right? One potential thing is the treatment of homosexuals in this country. And I don't have any data to, support this, but modern family seemed to have a whole heck of a lot to do with a change in public opinion over gay marriage. Modern family is not a reasoned argument, right? It's a kind of goofy show that happens to feature and humanize people that up until that point had kind of been out of public view. And the idea is if we can make people sort of regular features of the environment, right? Think of it from the perspective of that person. What do they actually see? I suspect that if I walked a day in the shoes of a Trump supporter, right, and not to talk to him, but yes, not to him. Their day-to-day life is going to be really, really different from mine. The kinds of things they hear, the kinds of conversations they have with other people, the kinds of things they see, right? It's walking in the shoes of anybody, right? Different belief sets. They're going to inhabit sort of different, what we call it, sort of informational ecosystems, different things that their brains are responding to. I think the answer is sort of an ergonomic one. You have to change environments to change minds. And maybe what that means is more multiculturalism in movies and TV and film. Maybe it's public campaigns. I mean, if I knew exactly what the answer was, I would run off and do it. But I think it's got to be something like that, right? If we think of these heuristics as sort of being molded to environments, if we can't change the heuristic, we got to change the environment to make it trip in different ways. And then the trick is just figuring out how to do that. I leave to future work.
Yes, sort of related to that. So one thing I find fascinating is when a person with a position is presented with facts that are against that position, it often makes them even more attuned to the position they began with.
Yeah.
What's the basis of that, and how can one combat that? Because I think that, it always fascinates me. You were talking about the word play of save versus loss, right? Death tax, estate tax, right? Anti-abortion, pro-life. And so I think that all kind of fits together. I was just kind of wondering your perspective on that and how to maybe do an end run around that when having a conversation.
I can say a little bit about it. I won't dominate the panel here, but I do have some thoughts on it. The first bit, right, we've got this confirmation bias and disconfirmation bias sort of playing the filter, right? I think another thing that's really important, especially when you have debates with people, one reason why they dig in is that we've really been encouraged to identify with our ideologies, right? So this is why I quit having political arguments with people on Facebook. because I realized that this what was going on had sort of the superficial form of a debate. But really what it was us justifying our identities in front of third parties. For me to change my view on something would be for me to give up something about myself, right? I would be switching teams in some way. And I think there's something about the sort of intellectual, or not the intellectual, but sort of the cultural landscape that's led us to sort of say, you know, I am a liberal, I am a conservative, I'm a person that believes X, Y, and Z, and if it were exposed that I didn't have any good reasons for believing that, that would be really deeply destabilizing, right? So this notion of cognitive dissonance, right, that would, and we find it upsetting, right? And we probably should, in some cases. How do we fight it? I mean, two things. One is just admit the fact that we're walking around with tons of false beliefs in our heads and we don't know that. And that we are systematically irrational beings, right? Well, one thing I said, you know, xenophobes are rational, I agree. One moralist, yeah, all of us are. Because it's really hard to be rational. And so admit the fact that we can be wrong and don't identify with anyone's position so much, right? Try to be more fluid. The other thing I found is if you're gonna argue with somebody, talk them down a little bit first and say, hey, look, I'm not trying to be aggressive here. I'm really interested in finding out what you have to say. Teach me something about where you're coming from. And as soon as you can do that, then all of a sudden it's not an antagonistic thing so much anymore. Might become one later, right? I don't know. Right? That's where the interpersonal communication piece is solved. But something like that. But I do think that it's we identify with our ideologies, and so it becomes much more personal than just sort of the cool reason to, you know, exchange my ideas, whether we think it is or not.
Oh, just a really quick comment. Building on your question, so do you think it might also be useful to look at the fact that we're social creatures, we so desperately want to belong, and we're interacting all the time. So when it comes to those people who are making those comments, you can sort of change, I mean, you want to have systematic change, like cultural change, we absolutely need that, but in the meantime, the way we interact with each other, so the person who makes the xenophobic comment, call them out on it, say something about it, start to change the temperature in your own social sort of communities. There's this term called the feminist killjoy. and I think it's awesome. So make people feel uncomfortable when they say that sexist thing. Make people feel uncomfortable when they say that racist thing. Because if we start to feel embarrassed about being closed-minded, there's going to be a strong push, I would make the case, to being open-minded and open-hearted, maybe.
Do you want to?
Yeah, I want to comment on that. So basically, we need to stop being scared, as you said, about defining ourselves as Syrians and as people who know Syrians. So when somebody says a racist thing, then we need to stand up and say, okay, this is not right. I'm Syrian and I know a lot of Syrian people and that's not right. And we need to stop being embarrassed. Okay, if I say I am Syrian, I'm gonna be scared. He's gonna look at me differently. No, but I'm a good person and I'm Syrian. Then when he sees you or she sees you standing up and showing that you respect yourself first and you respect where you come from, then they will start to respect you and consider your ideology and your thinking. So it's first, as you say, it's just we need to change our own environment. And change takes a lot of patience. It's not gonna come like by a word or two words. I mean, some societies to change have to sacrifice hundreds of thousands of people, right? So it all takes patience and it all takes a lot of work. But when we are committed to that work and to that patience, then we can actually make the change happen.
Related to your question, I'm a very strong believer in a diverse workforce. That is something that is a true culture changer, because if you think of the people, you said a lot of people don't have access to university setting or this kind of higher educational setting where there's a lot of research going on and a lot of really literary knowledge being exchanged. But the majority of people are in the workforce. And if you see work, like if you look at different companies, different groups of people at work, you see there's a lot of alienation. You see that, you know, lower income jobs go to specific kind of groups, and you see like there's not much diversity in those kind of groups. And I feel like that's where a lot of the people that you were trying to refer to that, you know, you have lower income, no exposure, you know, to other kind of people or sources, only from the media, then you have those really strong opinions, and they every day get stronger, those opinions, because they associate themselves with people in their workforce that have similar opinions, look the same, act the same, do the same, everything. But if you have diverse workforces, and it's a very hard thing to have, but if the more you have those in different industries and different companies, top high earning jobs to low earning jobs, the more you have this kind of forced communication that is on a daily basis, that doesn't just, you know, limit itself to one exchange where, no, I think you're wrong, you know, you're doing something wrong, and then each person goes to their houses, and then, okay, someone called me out, you know, nothing much changed. But you see continuous behavior on a daily basis, you interact with people, and then that breaks the ice, and then you have questions being asked. And I've experienced this on a personal basis. I've seen how diverse workforces break this and really produce a change in mindsets, and not just, you know, an exchange. I feel like it's something very essential.
There have been a couple reactions, but I was querying from the other side. We're all talking about how our biases stand and what we can do about it, but and you just talked a little bit about the reaction of those to whom we're biased, and how do they struggle with that and deal with it, and personally, not just to educate us back, but to cope with it in themselves and their families. And I've had some experience with a doctor that I just thought was wonderful, but he felt like, one day he said to me, I've been profiled to be pulled over by the cops 20 times more than you. And this is a wonderful person. And you know, I never had that thought, but, and we don't have, I mean, you know, people like me who are not, or don't have that kind of visibility or sense, you know, we're ignorant. And he talked about how his whole family, and I mentioned, he knew something about some background of mine, and somehow we got talking about our children, and I said, well, I guess your children go to day school, you know, they don't get discriminated against. And he said, no, they wouldn't, I'm not going to let them go there, because they'd be accepted there. They need to go to the public school where they're going so they can learn how to be part of our society and cope with the discrimination or whatever it is. And so I, you know, my query was to come back to those who are on the other side of this presentation and ask how they feel.
I'm not sure clearly about the question. Like, I understand what everything is said, but what exactly is the question?
Have you experienced any backlash, like when people are potentially judgmental to you? Do you guys want to speak? Is that what you're
thinking? Yeah. So mostly in the society we live in, we always go to classes where people are educated, are aware of many things. But when you go on social media, for example, and look at a post from Donald Trump about Muslim community in America, then you start seeing all kinds of voices and all kinds of racist ideas. The idea here is they built their success on the ignorance of people. That's the point. So Donald Trump built his success on the ignorance of people because they don't know much about it. That's the point. So that's why we need, as Syrians and as Americans who know about Syrians and know that there are good Syrian people, to stand up and speak out, because if we keep stay silent and afraid of talking about it, then nothing will change. So it might happen to us every once in a while, but it's not a significant thing. I don't think so.
I mean, I agree absolutely with everything you've said about what you said about the diverse workforce, but if we just simply look at the numbers, I don't think it's possible for us to expose each and every American to a Middle Eastern or to break the ice. So it is possible to get a huge majority of people to know more people from the Middle East, and it's a very great way to break the ice and stereotypes. But fundamentally, what I believe in is that we need people to change their fundamental beliefs, not to rush to simple solutions and simple arguments, not to rush to discrimination. It's a hard thing to do. It requires more education, but at the end of the day, I think it needs a personal dedication to do it.
I can pinpoint the exact dilemma that made me open to things that I had not been open to before. And I was 19 years old, I was at school in the Art Institute of Chicago, and I became best friends with a Jewish girl from Baltimore whose family had been going to Israel every year since she was in diapers. But not only did they go to Israel, they went to Palestine many times. And she told me, and I grew up right here, she told me, and it still gives me chills, she goes, she was telling me about the Palestinian perspective, this Jewish girl. And I'm like, they have a perspective? I mean, honestly, at 19, growing up here, I had no idea there was anyone in the United States who thought that Palestinians had any legitimate argument. And I was just like, but my question is, and it's to you, I heard it, and I listened, and I'm like, okay, wait a minute, I have to think that everything I've learned is subject to scrutiny, and that I have to be open, I have to look for sources, I have to do all these things. But why was I able to do that? What made me, and why can't more people? I mean, I just heard it, and I'm like, okay, you rocked me, and I'm listening. You have my attention. I came back to my parents, and they were like, okay, maybe that's part of it. They were like, let's look at it. They didn't say no. Republican family here, you know? Conservative, you know, whatever. But it was, I don't know, what made me, I'm so grateful to be the person I am that I was able to hear that, but why aren't more people able to hear that?
What color were the walls when you were? I mean, it's tricky, right? So you can be primed in to accept all sorts of different things, or at least you can be sort of nudged closer or farther away from certain kinds of judgments for all sorts of different reasons, right? So, you know, you're a teenager, formative years, there's a just whatever, this may have been a long time coming, right? A slow trickle of evidence leading up to sort of a critical decision point. And then you just got one of these kinds of, you know, sort of moments. In a different class, actually, we refer to these things as self-forming actions, right? There's sort of a critical point of sort of psychological instability where just the tiniest little nudge could kind of send everything cascading in one direction or another, right? Maybe that's what one of those kinds of things are. I mean, the one thing that I know that we're not good at doing, right, and for good reason, is that we don't wake up every morning and reconsider all of our beliefs to determine whether or not we ought to still hold them. Because that would take forever. And there would be a very inefficient way to sort of go about things. So why that thing at that moment? I mean, there could have been a host of emotional, psychological sorts of forces sort of conspiring right at that moment. The good news is that it happened. But what it would take to bring that same sort of moment of epiphany about in other people, I mean, that'd be awesome if we could figure out exactly what. But it's almost certainly wasn't because of this one thing you were ready.
Because what happened after that, when I went to Europe and I started reading newspapers that weren't American newspapers, and that was, you know, I was open to it, I was listening to it. And then after that, again, I remember I was in Paris, I think in 2007, woke up in the middle of the night, couldn't sleep, and Al Jazeera was on in French. Well, at that point, I mean, you can get Al Jazeera here now, but at that point, Al Jazeera was not in America. And I was sitting there listening to it, and I'm like, there was some bombing attack or something in Israel. It was the exact same reporting as I had heard earlier on CNN, but it was from Al Jazeera. I'm like, wait a minute, they're just reporting the facts. I was stunned. I still, even all those years later, I was still like, okay, hang on. Check again. Al Jazeera is just like CNN, only in Arabic, or in this case, with the French translation. You know, but it was those kinds of things are. I always let people. I'm always like, redo what you're talking about, but people don't do it, and I don't know why. And I guess that's what this whole thing is about. You know, why? Is it fear? Is it just that, I mean, it is, but why is the fear so, they're so afraid that they don't even want to approach it?
That's what's comfortable. That's what's the easiest approach.
Self-preservation. It's all about surviving.
But is it? Isn't it?
Irrationally, though, right?
Yes.
So it's like, this has the chance, potentially, to
caused me great harm, and so I will have nothing to do with it.
Well, I think a big part of it also is that they have to admit they're wrong. That goes with the self-preservation thing.
Yeah.
Okay, so this discussion's been wonderful. Thank you so much for everyone. We're going to have one more point, and I'm going to pass someone else. It's a surprise.
By the way, you can always surprise us. This is a panel where everybody come in. Surprise at the end. I'll be talking, first of all, thank you very much for a great, great, great lecture. This is amazing. And I'm going to bring up a point that surprisingly was not brought up by us, because maybe because all of us is on a higher level of education, that some big part of the community is not. Dr. Jones actually explained well, very well what xenophobia is, and the main source of it is fear. We fear. We fear other people. We fear a lot of stuff. And that's why we feel uncomfortable towards foreigner or anything else. And here, why do we fear these stuff? There are 2 points here I want to discuss. One is we don't know what is on the other hand. We don't know who he is, what's going to happen. There's a lot of stuff going on. Number two, we don't know why. Why are these people traveling over here? Why they are traveling all over the world? Why they are doing this stuff? You know, everybody knows that there's a crisis. Oh yes, it's all over the media. Everybody knows there's a lot of bombing and stuff. But the idea of taking a refuge, leaving your country, leaving your home, migrating with your children, who you've been trying to raise them very well for lots of years, this is a big, big, big jump. Why people do that? It's, again, everybody who wants to surprise us on this panel is welcomed. And this is, I just made that up, so I'm gonna follow. Here is something I found online, and thanks to Gail Benoit for letting me know about this. This is will explain why refugees do this. Why would you ever think about taking refuge in another country? It's not easy to take this decision, and here's the reason why. I'm not going to talk about it because other people did much better than me. Hopefully this works. It doesn't work. Hopefully we as Syrians can represent who are the people on the other end. This is our job to do, and here's something that can tell you why people are doing this. I think I should open this on YouTube. Unfortunately, this was viewed by 250 people. This is very low. But this is very meaningful, and it does mean a lot, and I wish it does you as well. Thank you very much for listening.
You have to understand that no one puts their children in a boat unless the water is safer than land. No one spends days and nights in the stomach of a truck unless the miles traveled mean something more than a journey. No one leaves home unless home chases you, fire under your feet, hot blood in your belly. It's nothing you ever thought of doing until the blade burned threats into your neck. And even then, you carried the anthem under your breath. I want to go home, but home is the mouth of a shark. Home is the barrel of a gun, and no one would live.